Hello everyone, I am Mrs. Sunita Dol, working as an assistant professor in Computer Science and Engineering Department of Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. Topic covered here is syntax analysis. Compiler is a program that reads a program written in one language and translates it into equivalent program in another language. Syntax analysis is the second phase of compiler, which is also called as parser or the hierarchical analysis. Every programming language has rules that prescribe the syntactic structure of well-formed programs. In Pascal, a program is made out of blocks, a block out of statements, a statement out of expression, an expression out of token, and so on. The syntax of programming language construct can be described by context-free grammar. The parser checks whether a given source program satisfies the rule implied by the context-free grammar or not. If it satisfies, the parser creates the parse tree of that program, otherwise the parser gives the error message. In this video, I am going to cover the role of parser and context-free grammar. Learning outcome. At the end of this session, students will be able to identify the different errors like lexical, syntax, etc. Know about error recovery strategies, write the derivation for the given expression, and draw the parse tree for the given expression. In compiler model, the parser obtains a string of token from the lexical analyzer as shown in figure and verifies that the string can be generated by the grammar for the source language. So, the parser works on a stream of tokens. It should recover from commonly occurring errors so that it can continue processing the remainder of its input. The methods commonly used in compiler are classified as being either top-down or bottom-up. Top-down parser builds the parse tree from top to bottom, while bottom-up parser starts from the leaves and works up to the root. In both cases, the input to the parser is from left to right, one symbol at a time. The most efficient top-down and bottom-up method work only on the subclass of grammars, but several of these subclasses such as LL and the LR grammars are expressive enough to describe most syntactic construct in programming language. If a compiler had to process only correct program, its design and implementation would be greatly simplified. But programmer frequently write the incorrect program, and a good compiler should assist the programmer in its identifying and locating errors. Program can contain errors at many different levels, for example, lexical, such as misspelling and identifier, keyword or operator, syntactic, such as arithmetic expression with unbalanced parenthesis, semantic, such as operator applied to the incompatible operand, and logical, such as infinitely recursive call. Error handler in parser has simple to state goals. First, it should report the presence of errors clearly and accurately. It should recover from each error quickly enough to be able to detect subsequent error. And third, it should not significantly slow down the processing of correct program. Error recovery strategies. There are many different general strategies that a parser can be used to recover from the syntactic error. First, panic mode. On discovering an error, the parser discards input symbol one at a time until one of the designated set of synchronizing tokens is found. The synchronizing tokens are usually delimiters such as semicolon or end, whose role in the source program is clear. The compiler designer must select the synchronizing tokens. This strategy is simple as well as guaranteed not to go into an infinite loop. Second, phrase label. On discovering an error, a parser performs local correction on the remaining input, that is, it may replace a prefix of the remaining input by some string that allows the parser to continue. A typical local correction would be to replace a comma by semicolon, delete an extraneous semicolon, or insert a missing semicolon. This strategy can correct any input string and has been used in several error repairing compilers. Its major drawback is the difficulty it has in coping with the situation in which the actual error has occurred before the point of detection. Third, error production. We augment the error grammar for the language at hand with the error production to construct a parser. If an error production is used by the parser, then error diagnostic can be generated to indicate the erroneous construct in the input. Fourth, global correction. We would like a compiler to make as few changes as possible in processing an incorrect input string. There are algorithms for choosing a minimal sequence of changes to obtain a globally least cost corrections. Given an incorrect input string X and the grammar G, these algorithms will find a parse tree for a related string Y such that the number of insertion, deletion, and the changes of token required to transform X into Y is as small as possible. Till now, we consider the errors at many different levels in the program and the error recovery strategies. Now pause this video and reflect on this question for a minute or 2 minutes and write your response. Once you return the answer to these questions, then you can restart playing this video. The question is, identify the types of error in the following example. I hope all of you have completed this activity. So the question was, identify the types of error in the following example. First, misspelling an identifier, keyword, or the operator is a lexical error. Hence, 12AB is a lexical error. Arithmetic expression with the unbalanced parenthesis is a syntactic error. Hence, option B is an example of syntactic error. Operator applied to the incompatible operand is a semantic error. Hence, 2 plus A of I is a semantic error. Infinitely recursive call is a logical error. Hence, option D is a logical error. Context-free grammars. Many programming language constructs have an inherently recursive structure that can be defined by context-free grammar. In a context-free grammar, we have a finite set of terminals, a finite set of non-terminals, a finite set of productions in the form A derives alpha, where A is a non-terminal and alpha is a string of terminals and non-terminals include the empty string, and a start symbol. Grammar for the simple arithmetic expression is given below. Notational conventions. Terminals. Lowercase letters early in the alphabet such as A, B, C. Operator symbols such as plus, minus, etc. Punctuation symbols such as parenthesis, comma, etc. Digits 0 to 9 and boldface string ID or the if are the terminals. Non-terminals. Uppercase letters early in the alphabet such as A, B, C. The letter S, which when it appears is usually the start symbol. Lowercase italic names such as expression or statement are non-terminals. Uppercase letters late in the alphabet such as X, Y, Z represent the grammar symbol, that is terminals or the non-terminals. Lowercase letter late in the alphabet, for example, U, V, X, Y, Z represent the string of terminals. Lowercase Greek letters alpha, beta, gamma represent the strings of grammar symbols. If A derives alpha 1, A derives alpha 2 and so on up to A derives alpha k are the production with A on left, then we may write A derives alpha 1 or alpha 2 and so on up to alpha k. Unless otherwise stated, the left side of the first production is start symbol. So, the grammar for simple arithmetic expression using these notational convention is given below. Derivation. So, derivation is a sequence of replacements of non-terminal symbols. In general, A derivation step is alpha A beta derives alpha gamma beta if there is a production rule A derives gamma in our grammar, where alpha and beta are arbitrary string of terminal and non-terminal symbols. The first symbol means derives in one step, second symbol means derives in zero or more step, third symbol means derives in one or more step. Derivation of string id plus id using the grammar for simple arithmetic expression is given below. At each step of derivation, we can choose any of the non-terminal in the sentential form of g for replacement. There are two types of derivation, leftmost derivation and rightmost derivation. If we always choose the leftmost non-terminal in each derivation step, this derivation is called as leftmost derivation. The top-down parser try to find out the leftmost derivation of the given source program. If we always choose the rightmost non-terminal in each derivation step, this derivation is called as rightmost derivation. The bottom-up parser try to find the rightmost derivation of the given source program in the reverse order. The leftmost derivation and the rightmost derivation of the string id plus id is given here. Parse tree. A parse tree can be seen as a graphical representation of a derivation. Inner nodes of a parse tree are non-terminal symbol, while the leaves of a parse tree are the terminal symbol. The leftmost derivation and the parse tree of the string id plus id is given here. The rightmost derivation and the parse tree of the same string id plus id using the grammar for simple arithmetic expression is given here. Ambiguous grammar. A grammar produced more than one parse tree for a sentence is called ambiguous grammar, as there are two derivation as well as two corresponding parse tree for the string id plus id into id using the production of simple arithmetic expression grammar. Hence, this grammar is ambiguous. These are some references. Thank you.